As more people were detained or killed, there were many more Nigerians fighting, demonstrating, and confronting the military. Virtually every segment of society, including the civil societies, the media, labor, and even those in the entertainment industry, joined the struggle. Months before he passed away on June 10, 2018, I got popular reggae artist Ras Kimono and his close friend Oris Wiliki to talk about those dark years of military dictatorship that icons like Fela and Nicolas Kuti fought until they died.
A lot of senseless killing out of that. If you listen to that, two did together, a lot of man them from Rewani, Lakidube,
they are murdered.
You know, Simbiko, Mali, Rita, Abiola, wife, a lot of man them murdered. Senseless killing that has no basis. So we'll talk about the senseless killing, and we'll talk about the backstabbing, and how do we keep moving forward.
We were not afraid to go to jail. We were very bold. In fact, many people today will say you guys were really strong at the time, because most people that were coming out doing crusades to campaign against the military, most of them ended up in jail, people like Ghani and all that. But something was working for us because we were using music. And so, like my friend would say, they couldn't understand the depth of what we were talking about. We were saying worse things than what those that were doing the campaign thing were doing. But because it was music inclined, God kept, you know, kept that ability to assimilate what we were talking about far from them. And so I'm trying to say that music is a powerful tool. We realized that, and we knew we could use it effectively, and it worked.
Many assassinations took place under the Abacha regime, but the one that perhaps shocked Nigerians most was the murder of Alhaji Kudirat Abiola, wife of the acclaimed winner of June 12 elections.
The assassination of Kudirat Abiola on the 4th of June 1996 was a sore point in the anti-military struggle and the struggle for the actualization of the June 12 mandate. With incarceration of MKO Abiola after his historic declaration at Ekpetedo, Kudirat Abiola became the backbone of the struggle to actualize June 12. But unfortunately, on this spot where I stand, on June 4, 1996, her life was cut short.
Kudirat Abiola was at the forefront, marching. We went to Ife, we went to several places. She was not even sleeping again. And she would always say something, and she's very fluent. I mean, she always could switch Yoruba, Hausa, English, very, very fluent in Hausa. So she will grant different interviews. Then she will always insist that even if she's killed or with threat to her life, she will not give up. So she became, I can use the word, she was so, I wanted to say fanatically committed, but she was so committed to the actualization of June 12th. And then when she speaks, it reverberates. So seeing her as that pillar, as that rallying point, as her voice, she, you know, she is like a thunder in the wilderness.
I was at a lunch, waiting to have lunch with Kudirat Abiola and a few other activists. And in the middle of waiting for her, we couldn't wait any longer. So we started our lunch. And then a few minutes after, the message came that she had just been shot on the streets, driving to the venue of the lunch. And for a lot of us, this is, you know, one of the things, rather than scare us, we felt incensed, we felt angry that this was going on in our country. And at some stage we decided, well, what was the point living in a country where you couldn't be a full citizen? And so for us it was, we either end this or we end with it. And that was the motivation for a lot of people.
I was riding in a car, but we had other assignments that we had to do. We had this number 090, this mobile number. So I was to drop off and meet her around 1 before the 4 o'clock appointment. So as soon as we drove her from the house, before then, somebody brought a list, those who were to be killed. I had my name there, a few other Comrade Olawuni, now late, and some other people. So Kudirat was, you know, where we looked at the list, and after that, she just put the thing aside. When we were driving, I dropped off, then she continued. It wasn't quite 3 minutes that I dropped. My phone rang, and I looked at it, and I saw that one of the aides called to tell me that Kudirat had been shot in the head. So where are you? We said Eko Hospital. So we started. I didn't even know how I got there. So getting there, the searcher died.
Hafsat Abiola Costello is the daughter of Kudirat Abiola and founder of the Kudirat Initiative for Democracy, KIND.
She had a lion's heart. She was very quiet. Very quiet, but very clear and principled. And she was compassionate. You know, sometimes I listen to some people in my social circle when they talk about the poor, and they say things like, oh, the poor people have always been poor. They know how to cope. We were just not raised to think in that way at all in our house. Our house was very clear that our compassion is for poor people. We must look for how to help them. We must look for always how to uphold their dignity, how to be a true friend. And this was the lesson from my father, who everybody knew had that kind of mindset and was so generous in his way. But it was also matched by his wife, my mom, because, you know, whenever my dad wasn't around and hundreds of people were coming, she was more than happy to receive them. I'm very sad, even till today, really. I'm very sad about everything that happened then. I'm saddened by the cynical role that so many people played, how they thought so much about their own personal interest, how they compromised for small change. And when you look, that was 1993, and when you look at the result, the consequences for Nigeria, it's painful. You know, we wanted to say farewell to poverty. We wanted to put Nigeria on a developmental path, which the country had been on at the point of independence and had gotten derailed from. And I just see that today Nigeria is still struggling with those same issues. And in fact, the struggle is in many ways even bigger now than it was then in 1993.
No matter how hard Nigerians resisted General Sani Abacha, he seemed determined to hold on to power and even transmute to a civilian head of state. His sudden death on June 8, 1998, however, changed all the calculations and saved Nigeria from a threat to its very existence. Abacha's death and his succession by General Abdul Salami Abubakar brought with it the fulfillment of the dreams of millions of Nigerians. Though MKO Abiola also died in suspicious circumstances during this period, Abubakar's government embarked on measures to heal the wounds, including the release of many people from detention and putting in place a transition program that returned the military to the barracks and enthroned a democratic government with Chief Olusegun Obasanjo as president. It is almost 20 years since that historic handover from the military to civilians, but many Nigerians are worried whether the bloody struggles and the supreme sacrifices of some of our compatriots were worth the trouble.
For those who died for this cause, they will never ever be forgotten, and their memory will remain evergreen. We fought. This is not what we crave for, where we are. But if we had not made attempts, we might have been worse off. So there is really no regret. The only thing is that for history not to repeat itself, Gani will always say that Nigeria is like a volcano that will erupt. We have to stop the killings. We have to stop this bloodletting. All these herdsmen, farmers attack. We have to stop it.
Nigeria is the biggest of all the countries in Africa in terms of population. It's the biggest economy. We have the most to lose and we have the most to contribute to the continent of Africa. So I really think that we cannot afford to wallow in self-pity and be thinking things like, it's not worth it, it's worth it. We have to focus all our energies on building this place.
There is nothing to regret about it. You pay a price for freedom. Freedom cannot be given you like a free gift. You have to fight for it. That freedom must, we continue to fight for it. Not just press freedom, but freedom for all Nigerians in various aspects of life. Today, we have a government that is civilian, but how much of freedom do we have? How much of the liberties listed in the Constitution do we have? The forces, anti-democracy forces, are still around, and we must continue to fight. We must not sleep. It is a lifelong battle.
For many, though the military at every point of intervention claimed patriotism was the driving force, the incursion of the military in Nigeria's politics has impacted negatively on the nation's development.
Military coups and things, they don't bring stability. They may hasten a little bit of way, as I said, in some form of development, but such development can only be entrenched if and last longer if democracy takes over. Each time a military government comes in, it's instability. Whatever democratic government you have, provided you maintain democracy, is better than any form of removal or changing of government or regime through the barrel of the gun.
This corrosive underpinning of what the military has done for us accounts for the fact that we are having difficulties organizing elections, because we still have that mentality and that tradition and that attitude at the back of our mind. It is the reason why governors cannot tolerate opposition in their own states. Where look at what you call state assemblies today. Look at what you call state local government elections in Nigeria today. Do they look to you like evidence of people who are anything but just tyrants and dictators? Because how does it happen that in a whole state, you organize local government election and the opposition cannot win a local government? Or you go to a national assembly and all that the speakers or so-called speakers decide is any speaker who annoys the governor goes away and a new speaker is elected and speakers simply go to collect whatever is their due.
That you could have a country like this, that is blessed with everything you can imagine in terms of human resources. I don't even want to talk about mineral resources that a bunch of people who do not even know. Because if you interact with many of these people who led all these military coups, they didn't really have a lot in them to offer. And the fact that they have held us down over these years and still continue to influence the trajectory of this country is really unfortunate.
Has the country learned any lessons from the past?
Democracy, if it's mismanaged, it becomes civilian dictatorship.
To know that you can know when a war starts, but you may never know when it will end, are the consequences.
Politics is about making our community better, not about making myself rich. I don't know whether Nigerian politicians really understand that.
I think that in another less than 10 years, the political cost is going to be so clear now that sooner than later, politics of ideas will begin to emerge.
The electoral process has to be able to filter out politicians that are not delivering, and citizens should be able to vote in candidates who represent their aspirations.
The elite are the ones creating these issues.
If God can take care of Abacha, and if I can put it that way, after the Civil War, Abacha's era was another dark.
On June 6, 2018, President Muhammadu Buhari recognized June 12 as Democracy Day.